So welcome back, guys, for another interesting interview. We have John Weatherby today, who's an amazing photographer, and I can't wait to get more into it and find out how he started, because he has a very interesting way in the way that he did that. But John, would you be able to just give a little short introduction about what you do, where you're based, what you've been doing the last couple of years, so people get to know you a bit better?
Yeah, sure thing. So my name is John Weatherby. I'm full-time travel landscape commercial photographer now. So I started off just taking pictures at a restaurant that I worked at in college. I was a waiter and I handled the social media. So I would take photos of the food with my phone and post them to Instagram. And then a photographer came in one day and did a photo shoot for the menu. And the photos that he took blew my iPhone pictures away, and I was just like amazed. So I was inspired immediately to get a camera and start learning how to take better pictures. And then I expanded out to taking photos around the community that I lived in, Tampa, Florida, and started kind of getting noticed for some of the city pictures I was taking, and asked to do, you know, paid photo shoots for other businesses and headshots, and people wanted to buy, you know, my skyline shots. And then I realized that I could do this for a living and make money. And that was kind of a slow progression, kind of building up enough clientele and work to sustain and do it as my full-time work. So eventually, you know, I was able to walk away from waiting tables and then become a full-time photographer. And that consisted mostly of shoots locally until I decided to really focus on my passion, which is travel and landscape photography. And over the past year or so, I've been able to basically land most of my work through the travel landscape capacity, whether it's doing photo shoots for companies or working with hotels or companies, you know, in other locations, shooting their products or licensing photos or selling my prints online. So there's a lot of different ways that I make my money now, but I've been fortunate enough to kind of find my way in the industry and do more of the stuff that I enjoy and kind of less of the stuff that really doesn't fulfill me. So
that's super exciting how you kind of manage to build yourself up from, you know, doing it in the restaurant and then seeing someone and buying a camera and thinking maybe I can do that, and then to where you are now. Like, that is, I think, fascinating and really interesting for anybody to watch and to even hear about. For those who, you know, maybe are even thinking of wanting to go into it, what would be some of your tips? Like, at the beginning, what were you sort of focusing on?
Yeah, so the beginning for me, I was figuring out how I could make money, and I was figuring out what I enjoyed shooting. So I think the goal is to find some point where those two intersect. So if you can figure out something you enjoy to do that makes really good money, then you've cracked the code. And at first, you know, you have to do the things you don't enjoy as much, I think, to make the money to kind of support the things that you enjoy. So for me, that was, headshots, real estate photos and stuff like that, that would support my funds to travel. And then I could do the photos that I enjoyed to, you know, do, that was my passion, kind of with the money from the others. So I think the beginning is kind of figuring out what you enjoy and developing that, and also figuring out how you can make money. And I think when you really focus on the aspects you're passionate about, then the rest kind of unfolds. I think I'm a firm believer that when somebody pursues their passion and the things that they enjoy for a career, that there's kind of like a natural acceleration. You know, I feel like the universe kind of works with you and kind of helps propel you into success. So that's been my experience. I've definitely had quick short-term success, I think, because people, when you're passionate about what you do, people pick up on that. You know, they really want to, like, they want to work with you. They want to help you pursue your dream and your passion, and they'll support it, you know? So yeah, I kind of got a little sidetracked, but
no, it's great. It's really interesting. I love, because a lot of one of the things that I'm picking up from a lot of these series that we're doing is this sort of not knowing, but this a lot of intuition that people have, a lot of belief that if you want it to happen, it can happen. To kind of focus on what you want to do and believe that you can do it wholeheartedly. And I believe that's also something that a lot of entrepreneurs have. You know, it's just that belief that you don't know how you're going to get there, but you know that you will get there. So it's great to hear that you also have that. And I think that's a kind of a trait that I'm seeing across the board. So I hope that people are kind of taking note of that, and just, I guess there's lots of reading material behind all of that. But you said short-term success. How long did it take you from when you started taking the photography in the restaurant to then doing the headshots and the commercial and the stuff that pays okay, you know, pays, but it's not the interesting part that you want to do, to then being able to do it as, you know, traveling the world again, these amazing landscapes? What was the kind of time frame for that?
Yeah, okay, so I started doing it for work outside of the restaurant very quickly. I was getting asked to do real estate photos, and people would see the cityscape photos that I would post. And it's so funny how it works, because they'll say, oh, these cityscape photos are amazing. You know, do you do family photos? It's like completely unrelated, but they just think because you're good at this, that you're also good at this. So I attribute the kind of the recognition or the awareness in my community because, and this is social media. Social media is so powerful. Social media can put you in front of people that can hire you. So my Tampa photos gained traction and got shared by all these Tampa social media pages. And then people that own their own businesses in Tampa saw those photos and then reached out to me to hire me to do work. So I always say that if people don't know who you are, they can't hire you. So the more exposure you can get, whether that's networking in person or online, doing stuff like this podcast, or just kind of getting in front of different audiences, I think that you're going to have more success, because it's a numbers thing. Statistically, the more people that are aware of your service can reach out and hire you. So, but I started doing work with the photography within a year. I was doing it kind of as a side job. And then within, I would say, a year and a half, 2 years is when it really started to pick up. And I would actually take off work to, you know, do the photo shoots and everything. And within 2 years, I was able to pursue photography full time. And then, just like I mentioned, in this past year is when I've really put my focus on travel and landscape, and really, you know, paying more attention to opportunities in that realm than the other stuff that I don't enjoy as much. And that's when I've been able to pretty much have my full-time income from all the stuff that I enjoy doing, and teaching photography as well at these amazing locations. And so going back to the mindset, like you mentioned, I think that I had a kind of a limiting belief earlier on that I couldn't, you know, do the things that I enjoyed the most and make money. I had to kind of do these other aspects of photography that would pay well, but that didn't provide as much income. But I think that there was a shift, and that's through, you know, learning like the different resources, reading and stuff, that you can kind of develop the correct mindset to believe in yourself and like your capabilities, right? Like the possibilities. So yeah, just this past year, I've really dialed in the things that I enjoy doing, and I've been able to make good money doing those. So it's been amazing.
That's super inspirational to, you know, to kind of hear how you made it happen. I think that's a super bold move, to have been, you know, to have thought, you know what, I'm going to listen to what this guy's saying, I'm going to hold off, and I'm going to try and make it my passion. And now you're working with some of the biggest brands. You know, you've done work for the Hilton, T-Mobile, Home Depot. You've done so many different projects. What has kind of been some of your favorites to work on?
I really love the travel stuff. So the ones that you just mentioned were more kind of in the, I wouldn't say like landscape realm. Not to say that they were well-paying jobs, and they, you know, gave me some great portfolio material to pitch to other companies as well. But I think that the most that I've enjoyed is the working with different products and companies to take photos in like the travel landscape aspect. And also, as of recently, I started teaching workshops in different locations and stuff, and I've really discovered a passion for teaching. I mentioned, I'm not sure if the podcast was rolling at that point, that, you know, I'm developing the online course. So I'm really loving the teaching aspect now as well. And to be able to do that in other locations has been amazing as well.
What's an example of a place that you've been and you had to literally wait hours and hours and hours to get that amazing shot?
First thing that just came to my mind was actually an Iceland workshop that we had last September. It was late September, last week of September. We were at this location called Stocksness Beach, and this iconic mountain, Vesterhorn, is this really, really popular photograph mountain. And we had somewhat of a cloudy sky and just like this little kind of weak aurora show. And we were just waiting and waiting, and it was freezing cold. And we're standing out, you know, on the beach kind of in low tide and some of the water. So all of our feet are frozen and it's just not happening. You know, we're like, okay, so we're packing it in. We're going to the van to load all of our gear up. And it's like four in the morning at this point. And then all of a sudden the whole sky just explodes with aurora, like some of the best aurora displays I've ever seen. And we all grab our gear out of the van, go back out on the beach, and we wind up photographing, you know, for another like 2 hours. And that was a deal where we just waited and waited and waited to the absolute possible, you know, we're about to throw in the towel, and it paid off because we had, you know, we were still out and at the right place, you know.
But for you, how are you kind of still trying to upgrade your skills? Are you still looking online, or is it from going out? Do you have a mentor? How does that work for you?
Sure. I have several mentors in all types of different capacities. So I have people that mentor me in the business world, you know, finance, investment, business strategy. I have people that mentor me in photography. I have several different mentors, and I think that it's like super instrumental for people to have success. And that's the number one thing I recommend for sure, is to find somebody that either can help you personally, or you just find people like authors, you know, have books, people, you can read books by somebody and receive their mentorship indirectly. You receive their knowledge, and you can skip so many steps, in the process, and the trial and error, and the figuring the things out and making mistakes. You can learn to just skip over all of that stuff if you have the right information, you know?
And soon they'll be able to take your online courses.
Yeah.
So is that something that you've launched due to maybe not being able to travel because of the pandemic?
Yeah. So it's been an idea for a very long time. And if I had the foresight to see what was coming, it would have definitely been a focus of mine 6 months ago. To have these available during this time, because you know, everybody was stuck home for a long time. And I saw kind of my peers in the industry really capitalizing on that and helping. You know, this is a service, and it's definitely not taking advantage. It's really providing a helpful service to people. So it was beneficial, I think, for a lot of people to take this time. And myself, I was able to dedicate this time to planning out the whole course, scripting the lessons and everything, starting to shoot the lessons, starting the whole strategy of, you know, marketing it and getting it out into the world. And that wouldn't have happened, you know, at this stage had I not been home for the past 3 months. So good things are coming out of, you know, setbacks, right? So it's like, you know, it's all perspective. You can take it as, you know, a setback or an opportunity. And I took this as an opportunity to kind of take a step back from my business and look at how I could impact more people with less effort, right? So provide more service to more people through this online learning that doesn't require my physical presence and time, you know? So it's
fantastic, because you've literally added another source of income for yourself. So when you are in Iceland, or, you know, maybe you're in South Africa, wherever you are, and you're doing maybe one-on-one courses there, or possibly you're doing a shoot for maybe like a brand, you know, you're able to make money whilst, even when you sleep, you know, you're making money whilst people are taking these courses, but also you're helping other people, which I think is hugely instrumental. And on your website, I was going to ask you, you have a saying, and I wrote it down here, that the ultimate satisfaction is finding something you love and then figuring out, you know, how to make a living from it. But do you think someone's effort is enough, or do you think there's a bit of luck in there?
Yeah. So like I mentioned before, I think that there is luck or a higher power or whatever you want to call it. There's like a natural kind of helping hand involved. I think when you set an intention, like a goal, like a career goal, objective, that you're going to do what you're passionate about, and you pursue it, and you adapt the mindset that you can achieve it, and you take the action. The action is a huge, I think, part of the equation, because you can think about this dream all day, but if you don't start stepping in the direction of it and, like, you know, taking the actions necessary, then it's never going to happen. So law of attraction, I believe in, I think it's real, but I think that there's another piece of that, and that's actually taking the action.
Taking the action. Yeah. It's interesting, because in so many, you know, spiritual beliefs or religions, that's something that comes, you know, it comes across over and over, is the fact that, you know, I mean, in Christianity, it's like God helps those who helps themselves.
Faith, you know, without works is dead, right? Like, dead, you can believe it, but you have to do the works.
Yeah, you have to do the works.
Get the result, yeah.
Make it happen, 100%. When you kind of travel to all these different places, how many people do you take with you?
Yeah, so it's different in each capacity. Maybe it's a one-on-one workshop, or, you know, maybe a couple that wants to learn photography, so maybe two people. Or if it's a group workshop, then it could be five or six people. We have one in Arizona that we had to push back a few months, and luckily everything has opened up in the correct timeline to where we can still accomplish this next month with some new guidelines and precautions to make it safe for everybody, of course. But that, you know, like, that's going to be like a six person workshop with two instructors. So it's kind of a more intimate scenario where you have a little bit extra attention, you know, to learn a little bit more one-on-one kind of aspect. But yeah, it can be anywhere upwards of 10 people. That's the maximum we've done so far. But anytime that is from 6 to 10, you generally want a couple instructors to be able to kind of still keep track of everybody, make sure everybody's, you know, learning, enjoying, you know, not wandering off and getting lost and all that good stuff.
Where are you? So yeah. How do you think that,
you know, it's like these, some of these places, you really have to
be careful. I can imagine the canyons. You don't want to get lost there.
No, there's places in Iceland, and Iceland and the weather in general in Iceland's very, very extreme. And, you know, there's definitely risk in a lot of these popular destinations with cliffs and, you know, extreme weather and waterfalls and stuff. You have to be very careful and kind of plan for all that stuff.
How do you think, I mean, you've got the online course that you've kind of been working on during this pandemic. How do you imagine that your work is going to be impacted? You know, whether that's having less people, you know, in your courses, or when you yourself are, you know, going out to travel and do photography, how do you imagine that's going to change?
Well, I definitely see a huge increase in online learning coming. I know for sure that it's been around for so long. I wish that I had that foresight a long time ago, how important it is to create something that continues to, you know, generate an income in the background. Like you said, digital products or any type of service that you create once that continues to provide the services is very smart to set up in a business if you can figure out some aspect, whatever the business is. But I think it's going to keep increasing. And like I mentioned earlier, the more awareness of your photography or your business or service out in the world, the more opportunities. So even just in this beginning stage, I've been able to reach out to a lot of different companies that kind of I've been in contact maybe throughout the past couple of years, who are partnering with us in this, in some capacity, you know, whether that's providing a 30% discount on a tripod to everybody who participates. It's a win-win for everybody. If you can get creative with these type of business ideas where you can create a win-win scenario where a company can benefit, and then you can provide a value to the people who come to your business as well in the same process, I think that's definitely a big win. And yeah, I think that the increase in my services in the world is going to have more eyeballs on it from companies that can potentially reach out to collaborate with me, to partner with me on these type of projects, or hire me and pay me, you know, for an actual photo shoot or service as well. So I think it's the exponential, you know, potential with the internet is crazy. And
it's true.
I attribute my success to social media. Like, yeah. I said, everybody started hiring me in the beginning because they saw my pictures shared. So I think that social media is really huge. Right,
especially for photography. I mean, it's almost like your portfolio. Nobody's really looking at a website, or nobody has time to click. If in that grid in your timeline, literally people can see, and it's true, people see what you've been up to, and they're like, great, I can ask this person to do this or that for me, and it's easy to kind of contact you. So yeah, definitely, I feel like that is the future, is to just see that as,
yeah,
that is where you're going to be making. Yeah,
these are the future. These people are going to start producing content directly for mobile phones a lot more. You know, people are visualizing pictures in a vertical scenario now. So now I think that people are buying a lot more prints from me, kind of in that vertical, you know, landscape orientation now, more than the traditional wide, you know. Wow. My theory is that,
yeah,
you know, we're programmed by looking at their devices, you know, to look at things differently now. So
is that also impacting the way you shoot? Because what I imagine, yeah, you know, you'll be like, great, I see this amazing landscape, but now are you thinking this way?
Yeah, you're 100% right. So now I actually shoot both ways. And sometimes, and this is kind of embarrassing to admit, but my first instinct is to shoot vertically, because I know that, you know, a lot of my photos are going to be going straight to the internet and viewed, and that, you know, I'm also selling photos, you know, like I mentioned, prints and stuff in the vertical ratio as well. But yeah, I shoot both ways just to cover my bases, because I do have people reach out to me online and see the photo on Instagram that's posted 4x5 vertically, and they say, I love this photo, do you have the horizontal version of that? So just to cover my bases, I shoot both ways. Or you can shoot, there's tricks, right? So like, I'll shoot a landscape photo in the traditional horizontal, and then I'll make like a slide post on Instagram where I can do like a vertical crop. Mm-hmm. To show for the first slide, and then the next few slides will be like the full photo you slide through. So there's tricks to kind of work around that, but it has impacted the way I shoot and a lot of people I know.
So yeah. if you could choose, maybe, let's say, your top three brands that you'd like to work for next.
Yeah.
And I believe that this would be putting it out into the universe. Who would it be?
Oh, wow. Company or like a product or
anything. Man. Okay. Let's make it a bit easier.
Okay.
Your dream location that you haven't been to yet, you know, your dream location, brand, what would be that scenario? So it could be also location.
Okay. So location, let's see. I have quite a few locations I need to get to. I need to get to Dubai and the Faroe Islands, and I need to check out the Maldives. Mm-hmm. And yeah, that's a good question. My brain is not working on this one right now.
So that is your homework.
Okay.
More for yourself. I love that. You're setting your homework.
It's challenging, I think, because my brain still works in a commercial aspect and the kind of travel landscape, because I'm still kind of making this transition. So I'm thinking of like clothing brands that I would like to work with, you know, maybe like a photo shoot for Arc'teryx, maybe like a campaign for them, you know, in Iceland or somewhere really epic where you can show the, you know, the durability and all this like crazy, you know, features. And then I'm also thinking like, what's my dream scenario working in the landscape capacity, like with a tourism board for the Faroe Islands or something, you know? So I'm like kind of split.
Okay. Yeah. So you have like, that's fair enough. You have like different branches that you're looking at. So this series of interviews that we're doing is part of a bigger campaign called Thank You Travel, where, you know, we're trying to give back to the travel industry, as well as our travel content creators and travelers in general. So would love to know, for you, what are you grateful to travel for?
I'm grateful to explore, to see new places and experiences. And for me, I spend all my money, extra money on experiences over, you know, material things. So I think I'm grateful to be able to like have the memory, you know, of this place and to be able to experience the new destinations and beautiful and witness the beautiful aspects and stuff as well. Or also the culture too. I'm really grateful to like, I have a lot of close friends in Iceland now, and you know, I'm very familiar with the culture and kind of, and I got immersed in that. Right. So like, I'm grateful to be able to learn more about the world through like the destination, but also the people at those destinations too.
That's amazing.
But also I did want to just mention, I'm grateful for the friendships. I kind of touched on that, but like making the friendships with these people in these different locations has been just as good as not better than the actual experience. It's part of the experience, but yeah. I have some very close friends that I've met through social media and through travel to a few different places, through photography and through these workshops, like guides and stuff like that, that I'm very close with now.
Yeah, I think it's amazing. You're making friends all across the globe.
Actually. Networking, honestly, I think your happiness and your success is going to be directly proportionate to your network.
100%. Okay, so without further ado, we are now going to have a game. Okay. So once I work out how I'm going to put up this PowerPoint for you to guess, so it's going to be guess the flag.
Okay.
You might have to just close your eyes for like 2 seconds.
All right.
Whilst Isla try and figure this out. Okay. Right. Are you ready? Guess the flag. Okay.
Based off colors. Oh, okay. Sweden?
Ooh.
No.
Maybe, maybe not. Are you sure? Is that your final answer?
No. I know the places from pictures better than the flags.
Okay. What are you torn between? Sweden and what else?
My first thought was Norway, but I don't think it's Norway.
Okay. Ready?
Yep.
It is Denmark.
Oh, man.
Horrible. Sweden, I think, is blue and yellow.
You know, the only one I'm going to get right is Iceland. I'm telling you this right now.
I don't even know if we have Iceland. Let me have a look. Okay. This one.
Oh, Lord.
So this one, I've not told you this actually, but I'm from this country. I was born there. All my family live here. I'm going to give you some clues.
France.
Yes. I don't know if this is cheating. Hopefully it's not. Okay.
Oh, I need some.
Next.
Home. Japan.
Konnichiwa. No. Arigato. Yes. You said Japan. Ding, ding, ding.
Oh, whew. All right.
All right.
Wetting over here.
What do you think this one is?
I have honestly no idea.
This one I've never really seen this flag before, so I'm quite embarrassed. It is Malaysia.
Malaysia, okay.
This one. Notes.
Oh, no, I know this one. This is Ireland? No.
Final answer. Yes.
Ireland. Oof. All right.
Final one.
No, this is not.
You follow rugby.
Yes.
Springboks. On last year's World Cup 2019.
So rugby. When you said follow rugby, I totally lied. I don't follow rugby. I'm aware of rugby.
Okay. All right. Let me think. Mosalvan Point. If this doesn't give it away, I don't know what it is. It's the Mosalvan Point of Africa.
Southern Point of Africa.
The clue's in what I just said.
South Africa.
Yeah.
Wow. All right. I clearly need to dedicate some focus and time on
geography. You don't take photos of the flags. You take photos of the scenery and so you don't need, don't worry.
Now I'm going to make a mental note to really be aware of more than just the scenery where I go.
Thank you. Well, I really, really appreciated having you, and I'm sure everybody learned so much more about, a journey of becoming a photographer and how, it can look like many different ways and how you can make it happen, how to diversify during a pandemic. And I wish you all the best. And if people want to follow you, that would be fantastic. Then we can see maybe what, which brand it is that you'll be working with. You'll be posting about it, right?
For sure.
Okay. So make sure that you look out, share, send some love, definitely follow. I was gonna say follow, like, and subscribe, but that's more YouTube. Do you have a YouTube?
I do. It's just John Weatherby.
Perfect.
John Weatherby Photography. So
Instagram, YouTube will be great because we get more tips, I'm sure, on photography. Also, you have an online course coming out soon. And if you want to, see more of these interviews and this series, then you can head to Travelxp's Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter. And this was Emeline signing out.
Yay! Bye, guys.